Hello everyone, welcome back to our third and final video on river systems. We're going to continue on talking about stream profiles. So as you move down a river, you have a number of characteristic features that tend to repeat themselves. So one of those are runs. So these are relatively straight, moderately depth rivers where you have flow kind of accelerating downstream. Then you have riffles, which are areas that are relatively shallow, wide, with a lot of rocks and vegetation. And so you'll form riffles in this region. And then lastly, we have pools, which are very deep sections of the river where the flow slows and you have like a swimming hole. And generally in a river, you'll have a repeating pattern of these three different stream features. So a riffle, run, pool system. So for example, here we have a riffle that forms and then flows into a run and then a pool. And this will repeat as it moves downstream. And you can see that in these photos as well. You have a riffle, a short run, and then a pool, and that riffle begins again. When you have steeper slopes, you start to form step pool profiles. So this is when you have steps that form in the elevation of the bed, followed by pools. So you can have a large rock, such as in here, here, and here, followed by a deepened pool. With relatively slow flowing water, and this will repeat itself as it moves downstream. And then lastly, we have cascades. So cascades form whenever you have a slope over a 10% grade, such as this one here that has a even steeper slope, and pretty much all of this pattern kind of gets thrown out the window. Instead, you have just water flowing over rocks whenever you have this steep slope. Next, let's talk about sediment transport. So sediment can be transported very well by the flow of rivers, and it's a very important process in geology and geography, just because rivers can carry so much sediment and move entire mountains downstream. So some of that sediment is the dissolved load. So those are chemicals such as salts and carbonates that might get dissolved into the water. But also you have suspended load. So those are the very fine particles such as clay and silt that are small enough and light enough that they can be transported within the flow itself, and they don't actually touch the river bed and just get entrained in the turbulence of the water. Next, we have bed load. So unlike suspended load, this is sediment that's moving along the bed. And this can happen through a number of processes, including saltation, which is the bouncing of rocks along the bed surface. And so you can see this rock gets lifted up and then falls back down, and this process can continue over and over. This is really important for bedrock channels, for example, because saltation and the bouncing of rocks on the bed tends to dictate their erosion rate. Also, we can have sliding, the rocks just sliding along the bed, and rolling as these are tumbling downstream. So we can define how much sediment and what size sediment a stream can transport using capacity and competence. So the capacity is the total amount of sediment that can move through a stream system over some amount of time, whereas the competence is the largest size that largest sized sediment that a river can move. You can see here that this river has a bunch of very large boulders all along its stream banks. And that's a good indication that this river, most likely during flood flows, has a very high competence. It can carry very large boulders. And we see that when we look at the different stream flows and how much competence and capacity there is, generally the competence is proportional to the velocity to the sixth power. So it takes very large increases in velocity in order to change the competence, the size that of sediment that can be transported. Whereas the capacity, the amount of sediment, is proportional just to the discharge, the amount of water flowing through the river. And then, lastly, another important concept in sediment transport is armoring. So this is a very similar concept to what we talked about previously with desert pavement, in which you have deflation of smaller grains due to aeolian transport. But in this instance, it's not the wind that's transporting the sediment away, it's the water in hydraulic transport. And so as that happens, you have deflation of the surface and a concentration of these larger rocks at the bed that are protecting the smaller, finer sediment from being eroded away. And we call that process, when it happens in a river, armoring. So there's a number of man-made structures that can also be built in a river system, most notably dams. And there's four different types of dams that are generally built within a river. So there's the classic arch dam, also sometimes called an eggshell dam. That's like the Hoover Dam, for example. We have gravity dams, where you just pile up enough concrete that it can actually hold the weight, and these tend to be straight dams, whereas the arch dam has a curvature to it. Next, we can have buttress dams, where you have these long stays or buttresses that help support the weight of the water pushing against that wall. And then lastly, we have earthen dams, where you have some concrete or soil that gets piled up with soil and more dirt in order to have enough weight to support the weight of the water. We can see examples of these here, these earthen dams, buttress dams, arch dams, and gravity dams, for example. Another interesting feature that sometimes gets built into dams are fish ladders. So fish have a extremely hard time trying to pass over a dam, and a lot of fish species need to be able to travel large distances through a river system. And so in order to accommodate them, we sometimes make fish ladders. So this is a series of cascading pools that flows down the down from the dam in order to fish in order for fish to swim up that ladder and reach the higher section of water. Additionally, we like to make levees, dikes, and flood walls. So these are impediments that prevent flow past a certain bank line. For example, this is a levee where it's been built up to try to maintain the river flowing in this channel and not flow into this more urbanized area. A flood wall is just a, as simple as it sounds, just a wall that's built up instead of an earthen levee that's used to protect against flooding. You can see a map here of all of the levees in the United States, with a lot of them located in the Mississippi River, as well as in the California Central Valley. And when we zoom in on New Jersey, we see that most of the levees in this state are located along Delaware Bay. These levees can get quite intense and lead to some social justice issues as people build levees around their houses and can, when the flood does come, form these islands. And so remember, when a river flows, if you're preventing flow from one area, that water is just going to be funneled downstream. And so sometimes when you build up levees in one area, you just get larger floods and more damage downstream. So sometimes that can pose a problem when you have a more wealthy municipality that's building up its levee system and just forcing more of that water into a less wealthy area that can't build as many levees. And then another feature are weirs, also known as low head dams. And so these are features that go across the entire reach of a stream or river, and they help control the water level at that specific point. So water flows over them continuously, and it's built there in order to try to maintain this water level for this area of the stream consistently. Sometimes you might see a weir that looks like this, you know, this sawtooth zigzag pattern. And that's in order to accommodate a larger discharge. So the amount of water that flows over a weir depends on the geometry of that weir, as well as the length and the height of the water above the weir. So sometimes engineers will form this zigzag pattern in order to extend the length of the weir. A zigzag pattern will take up a longer length than a straight path. And so the longer the length, then the more discharge that can be accommodated, and you can accommodate more flows as a result. So that just about covers everything about rivers that we're going to be talking about. So in summary, we talked about meander formation and the propagation of meanders. We talked about different types of rivers, anastomosing rivers, meandering rivers, and as well as drainage networks. We talked about antecedent streams and Strahler orders. We talked about delta and terrace formations. We talked about different river features such as nick points, stream profiles, sediment transport, and we just talked about man-made river structures. So I'll leave you guys with this video that I made in college about rivers and the impact of fire on rivers, which can significantly impact rivers. So yeah, let's watch that now.
Sasha the Science Guy.
River continuum concept. Watershed rule. 1893. Pool, riffle, run.
Sasha, science guy.
Fire. It's great. It cooks our food. It warms our houses. But if it gets out of hand, it can spread, well, like wildfire. And it can be really dangerous to everyone around it.
Yay! We're safe in the river!
Well, actually, fires can have a huge effect on rivers.
This entire area has been burned by the rim fire. Firefighters spent millions of dollars to make sure the fire didn't spread any further into Yosemite. Firefighters use prescribed burns and thinning to make sure that things like this that have a lot of fuel don't burn. When there's fire on the hill slope, all the plants burn. You see, the plants hold the sediment in place, making sure it doesn't flow into the river. The plants have deep root systems that cause infiltration to keep the soil in place and the water to go downslope. Without the plants, all the sediment ends up in the river.
Once sediment is in the river, it increases the viscosity of the water and bank scouring on the sides of the stream, an aggradation that clogs up valuable aquatic habitat.
The amount of water flowing down the river determines the size of the particle that can flow down. clay, the smallest particle, takes the smallest amount of force to move down the river. Next up, there's sand. Sand, like you see on the beach, takes a little bit more force. As we get to even larger flows, grains like pebbles and gravels can move downstream, and cobbles, and eventually giant boulders. Sediments deposit where the river widens, or where there's a curve or meander in the river. At the deepest part of the river, called a thowag, we get sediments like these cobbles depositing in the stream. Further along the bank, we get smaller particles, like these sands. And at the very edge, we get the finest particles, like the silt. Macroinvertebrates and fish like to live in eddies like this one, where the water is recirculating around away from the main channel.
When sediment deposits in the eddies, it hurts the bugs and fish that live there. It fills in the spaces between the larger rocks that macroinvertebrates like to live and fish like to lay their eggs. The sediment decreases the oxygen concentration in the water and alters the food available to the larger bugs. Fish prefer these bugs, and if they're gone, it can hurt their population.
When water flows quickly downstream, it can move the sediment on the bed. At slower flows, the sediment rolls on the bed, and at faster flows, it bounces or saltates along the bed. And at the fastest flows, it becomes entrained, which means that it gets picked up and moves as suspended sediment downstream.
Now hold on, Sasha the Science Man. Doesn't all the sediment go downstream?
Well, actually, little Scotty, the process can take decades, if not centuries, and it can have huge detrimental effects on sedimentation downriver. Make sure you put out your campfires to be safe with fire, because you can prevent forest fires.
Yay, yay, fire safety!
All right, so maybe that's a little bit cheesy, but I think it kind of points out fairly well how fires affect rivers and also demonstrates some of the concepts that we talked about earlier in this lecture. So thanks everyone for watching, and I will see you guys next week. All right,